Do we have anyone here this morning besides myself with the shofar?
Mine's still on the way.
You're still on the way.
Yeah.
David,
to bring it.
Where's your shofar?
Camera.
I have one.
Come, Megan.
I haven't worn it in a long time, so we don't know what sound we're going to
do. Between the two of us, we might make one sound. Oh, bless the Lord. Let's stand and let's invite the Holy Spirit with the sounding of the shofar. The intensity of your presence.
Yes.
Father, let God arise in all of us and his enemy be scattered today.
Yes.
Let there be a sound of joy and victory in the camp.
Yes.
Fathers, we talk about the blessings that are going to come down on this last day on your people, both natural and spiritual. May something arise in our heart and trigger that witness which we're going to share is their portion.
Yes.
Father, we thank you now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Doctor, I'm going to invite my sister, Megan, to lead us to the Shema.
Everyone could just remain standing and turn to face the east as we anticipate the day when Yeshua will return to Zion. Shema Israel, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad, Baruch Shem Kevod, Blessed be his name, for his glorious kingdom is for all eternity. Amen.
Amen, amen. As it's become the custom, I would like to have a volunteer to lead us in the Nishan room, which I will put up on the screen. Any volunteer?
The children of Israel shall keep the Shabbat, observing it throughout their generations as an everlasting covenant. It is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed. And it shall come to pass that from one new moon to another, and from one Shabbat to another, all flesh shall come to worship before me, says the Lord.
Glory, glory, glory. Amen, amen.
Great God, that's a promise.
If you know it, please join me.
The Shamru, Bene Israel, Yehashabah, Lassol. The Doro Tamburitola Baby Ovin Bene Israel O Tehili Ola Kisheshet Yamin Asai Adonai E
good it is and how pleasant it is for brothers to dwell together.
See you.
says the worship team finished doesn't mean that the praise is stopped. He is worthy of all praise when we have music, when we don't. When we have people, when there's no people, he is worthy no matter what. All our praise, all our worship, all the honor, all the glory. Amen. Can I invite my brother David to continue to lead us in some worship?
Israel never ceased to be a nation. Yerushalayim, where my righteousness dwells. They will return with tears of repentance and bind themselves to me forevermore. They will know me as their Lord. In that day, at that time, a search will be made for Israel's sin. None will be found. No, none will be found. I will make her enemies fall. For I will rescue you, rule over all. I rule over all. They will cry out to me, Baruch Abba, B'Shem Adonai, blessed be the name of our Lord. Baruch Abba, Yeshua, I will hear and answer them, reveal their salvation forevermore. They will know me as their Avi Adoni Echi. My love, my Lord, my salvation. Avi Adoni Echi. My love, my Lord, my salvation. Israel Tamshik Lahit Chaim Lenetzach Yerushalayim Hekam Sheruki Shokenet Him Yachzeru Bemaot Shel Tuva Ve'yapelu Atzman Elay Lenetzachim Yeduni Ke'adon. Bayom ha'hu, bayet ha'hi, lo timatze edot ledatat, lo timatze, lo timatze. Hineni poshe et egron, letzenayet lepo, poshe lavako, poshe lavako. Yitzikalu Yelai Baruch Abba B'Shem Adonai Baruch Shem HaAdon Baruch Abba Yeshua Ani Eshma Ve'ashav Elehim Amitzi Et HaYeshua Lenetzakim
This morning, we need quite a bit of prayer because we've got a lot to cover. I've got some prophetic stuff that God has given me to share this morning. And my cry is that we hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. What God is about to do is bigger than anything we can conceive. He said, eye has not seen, ear has not heard, neither hath it entered into the heart of man the thing that God has prepared for those that love Him. So let your mind go. Let it run. And when you're finished, it's going to be bigger than that. So this morning, our portion is on the patriarchal prophetic blessings. And I'm not even sure how to go about sharing what I have in my heart, so just hold with me, hold steady, and let's see what God will do with us. Because if He doesn't do something with us, we are in trouble. All right, turn in Genesis 48, 1 and 2, and it shall come to pass after these things that one told Joseph, behold, thy father is sick, and he took his two sons, Manasseh and Ephraim, and one told Jacob and said, behold, thy son Joseph cometh unto thee. And Israel strengthened himself and sat up in bed. 48, 5 and 6. And now thy two sons, Ephraim and Manasseh, which were born unto thee in the land of Egypt, before I came unto thee in Egypt, they are mine. That is very, very significant because we find them all the way in the book of Revelation. So, we'll talk about the listings in a moment, but Jacob took Joseph's two children and brought them into his family direct. And he said to Joseph, if any other sons are born or any other children are born, they're yours, but these are mine. Okay? Isn't that what he did with you? Didn't he say, you are mine?
Yes.
Not a grandparent anymore. Okay? They are mine as Reuben and Simeon, they are mine. And thy issue, which thou begettest after them, shall be thine. And it shall be called after the name of their brethren in their inheritance. Now the naming of Joseph's sons is strategic in understanding the work of God in Joseph and the work of God in you. Okay? After Joseph came to the throne, he was given an Egyptian, the daughter of a heathen priest, for a wife. She bore him Manasseh. Now catch this. Whose name means forgetfulness. Joseph named him for the experience he had in God. There are some things you're going to name in your life, and you need to name them according to the experiencing of God. Okay? The order of birth is as important as it is the order of blessing. Genesis 41 and 51, and Joseph called the name of the firstborn Manasseh. Now here's what he's talking about. Here's my experience, and I have enshrined it in my son prophetically. See, back then they named the kids and the names were prophetic. I have a sneaky prophetic suspicion. And that is that God is in charge of the naming of our children. We think we did it. But if we look at the meaning of their name and follow their lifestyle and what they've done, we may just see the prophetic ability of God to name a child according to his destiny. Okay? So, Joseph said, "For God," said he, "hath made me to forget." You know, some of us need this. We need God to come in and make us forget some things. Amen. Not Alzheimer's. I don't think there's a whole Holy Ghost Alzheimer's. But I think that there's some things that the enemy bugs us with that God wants to anoint us to forget.
Amen.
And in the forgetting, there's healing and wholeness comes.
Yes.
Okay? So, he said, "God has called, made me to forget all my toil and all my father's house." The weary, you know, when we read the story or the account of Joseph while he was still in Canaan, we don't read of the weary effort, the worry, the mischief, or the miserableness. That's what that word toil means. So, we look at the incidents and we look at them. Yes, there was problems when he, you know, went down to the brethren and went through that. But before that, he had some misery, worry, anxiety, and wearing effort in his life. God has made me to forget. Oh God, send your spiritual forgetfulness in your church so your church can move forward. Because the enemy uses our past against us. Even though our sins are never to be remembered against us anymore. Tell the devil that. When he's bothering you about something you did in your past that you've been forgiven for. I often say, tell the devil to go to hell. That's where he belongs.
Amen.
All right?
See you.
Well, he's going to go to the lake of fire eventually. But all right. So, all the hardship in my parental home. You know, each sibling sees their history and their childhood different than their other sibling. I'll never forget when I, you know, that dawned on me. I have one brother, he's 11 months older than I am, and he's always right. He told me so. And he said, "I will always be right. I'm the oldest." And he saw our childhood much different than I did. But in Joseph's life, he saw the hardships of his life. Now the great thing about this is Joseph let God work something in him through all that. You know, you can have two kids go through the same upbringing and one will be godly and one will be ungodly. And it's how they handle these things. So the second son, which means fruitful, was Ephraim. And the name of the second son he called Ephraim, for God, I like this, God hath caused. You know, there's some things that God wants to cause in your life. I remember in my study one day, I came across this phrase, cause me. Cause me, not cause be, cause me. And the Lord said, study all the things that you can pray I cause you to do. You see, when I invite him to cause something to happen in my life, I give up my rights. Okay? And when I give up my rights, he says, goody. Because I can do what I want to do. I can make him what I want to make him. And so, God hath caused me. It wasn't anything I done. God has caused me to be fruitful in the land of what? My affliction. Hello? You mean I can even be fruitful in the land of my affliction? God says yes. Guess what? He never lies. God wants us to recognize that it is His heart, even when going through a time of affliction, and that word means straitened circumstances, I can prosper. God can bless me. God can make me fruitful. I am convinced a lot of that depends on my attitude while going through it. In Genesis 48:13-14, and Joseph took them both, Ephraim in his right hand toward Israel's left hand, and Manasseh in his left hand toward Israel's right hand, and brought them near unto him. And Israel, now listen, when it says Jacob, a certain thing is being pointed to. When it says Israel, a greater thing is being pointed to. And Israel stretched out his right hand and laid it on Ephraim's head, who was the younger, and his left hand upon Manasseh's head, guiding his hands wittingly, for Manasseh was the firstborn. Now, I just had this question on my way, so I'll put it down. Did Joseph favor Manasseh over Ephraim, or was he just being traditional? Sometimes we be traditional and we're wrong. But Israel guided his hands prophetically. Genesis 48:18-19. And Joseph said unto his father, not so, my father, for this is the firstborn. Put thy right hand on his head. And the father refused and said, I know it, my son. I know it. He also shall become a people, and he shall be great. But truly his younger brother shall be greater than he. Do you realize he's passing on a generational inheritance? Why? Because the prophecy over Jacob was, the elder shall serve the younger. Here it is being passed on in Joseph. And his seed shall become a multitude of nations. Ephraim became the more dominant one historically. Now, this is interesting. You see here the little map in the corner. Ephraim is the smaller territory, but has the greater blessing. Size does not matter. It's not the size of your inheritance, it's the blessing of God upon your inheritance. Manasseh, that's a whopping amount of Israel, isn't it? And yet he was to serve the younger. Genesis 48:20-22, and he blessed them that day, saying, in thee shall Israel bless, saying, God make thee as Ephraim and Manasseh, and set Ephraim before Manasseh. And Israel said unto Joseph, behold, I die, but God shall be with you, and bring you again into the land of your fathers. Here he is speaking prophetically in the same line as Abraham had spoke to Isaac. And God had spoke to Abraham. God's going to bring you back to the land of your fathers. Moreover, I've given thee one portion above thy brethren, which I took out of the hand of the Amorites. You trace that to the root, it means to boast in self. So none of you have any animal rights in you, do you? Oh well, we won't go there. Which I took out of the hand of the Amorites with my sword and my bow. That means I'm going to have to fight myself. Okay? The portion he gave him was the portion of the firstborn, because the firstborn received two portions of the inheritance. He was the firstborn of Rachel, but not the firstborn among the brethren. The appointment of responsibility was given by Jacob, by the prophetic voice, not just because, you see, it's so important that the prophetic was involved in this, because we see that God speaks prophetically above tradition. The This has multiple applications spiritually, and yet the Messiah did not come from Joseph, even though he was given the firstborn portion. It came through the one who took responsibility of the firstborn, which also has great significance. So we begin the patriarchal blessings. And this is so poignant for these days. And Jacob said unto his sons, called unto his sons and said, gather yourselves together, that I may tell you that which shall befall you when? In the last days. In other words, Jacob saw all the way down to today, prophetically. Gather yourselves together and hear, ye sons of Jacob. And sons of Jacob, hear the prophecy of Israel, your father. He's speaking from the Israel position, or the national head, not the father position. He saw down to the end of the ages, speaking from the new nature of Israel. Here we have an illustration of the blessings of the father, or generational blessings. These have fallen, by the way, even in Christianity. There is something about generational blessings. Now, I did not meet my father till I was 7 years old, had no real relationship with him until 5 years before he died. And there's some things I learned along the way. I learned that there's a special tie regardless of whether you have a relationship with your father or not. It's a spiritual tie and a soulish tie. And so, the last 5 years of my father's life, he had come to the funeral of his brother, and I was there. And I said, Dad, can we have any level of relationship? He said, I got to go home and think about it. Because he had been deeply wounded by the church, and I'm a preacher. I mean, no, that sets up a thing right there. And so he went home and he said, well, I will visit your daughter and you can come and see me at her place. I said, good. Because I was out to repair whatever, at whatever level I could. But I found that when he passed, something happened in here. Now, we weren't close during those last 5 years, but we were in relationship. And I began to say, wait, God, there's something here. And then I said, God began to speak to me about generational blessings. Well, my father was in the Roman Catholic Church all of the religious life that he had. And I said, God, I don't know of any generational blessings that would come from there. Here's what God said to me, and we need to catch this, okay? He said, you have people in your father's line who are priests and nuns. They answered the call of God as best they knew it. You inherit that. And how many know that messed my theology? It just kind of just, because I've been taught that the Roman Catholic Church is the Antichrist. And the woman that sits upon the beast, and there's nothing good in her. And then the Lord took me to an interesting scripture. Come out of her. Oh, you mean his people are still in there? How many know that messed with my theology? You see, we're the ones that put the limits on God. God did not put the limit on himself. And so we need to hear God above our traditions. And we all have them. Even if they're atheist traditions, they're traditions. God is out to show himself strong in these days. Yes. And because he's going to do that, he's going to do marvelous wonders that are beyond anything we could ask or think. And so, get ready. Or I could say like T.D. Jakes, get ready, get ready, get ready. But something's coming above and beyond anything we can imagine. Amen. and it is good. Okay? Each son is blessed prophetically, and tracing the history down through the ages proves the accuracy of these prophecies. Now, there are 13 listings of the 12 tribes in Scripture, where all the tribes are mentioned. They are extremely important in understanding the dealings of God with families, local churches, and the body of Christ at large. You will find the church groups who manifest different aspects prophesied concerning the 12 tribes. There are churches of the tribe of Judah, of Issachar, and so on down. See, he has called us the body of Christ, not an organization. They define the journey of the Israel of God spiritually. Remember, see my little balance beam? I like to put it out when I'm teaching. Because there's the Israel of God and there's natural Israel. And there are those who say, well, God's through with natural Israel because we have the Israel of God. No. God has two eyes. Israel in the natural is the apple of one eye, and the church is the apple of the other. Balance, balance, balance. And I won't get on that because that's another one of my hobby horses I love to ride. All right. In 1 Corinthians 10 and 11, now all these things happened unto them for examples, and they are written for our admonition. Whose admonition? Ours, on whom the ends of the age are come. Okay? The Darby version says all these things happened to them as types and have been written for our admonition upon whom the ends of the ages are come. I think that's the Dewey Rames. Now all these things happened to them in figure and they're written for our correction upon whom the ends of the age are come. What does that mean? That means we're going to fall into some of the same types of stuff that they did, and we need correcting.
Yes, yes.
Why? Because we're human nature. We're still yet the fallen nature. God's working on that, okay? But we still have those things that come up that are clearly the fallen nature. The B.W. Johnson commentary, actually. Now, these things happen to them for examples, and they are historical facts designed to teach great lessons, since God still deals on the same principles. Those who do away with the Old Testament can never come to full maturity. I said, they that do away with the Old Testament can never come to full maturity, because they do away with the illustrations that God gave for us to come into the fullness. Okay? Now, although the illustrations used are from the wilderness history of Israel, the weaknesses and flaws manifest are the same weaknesses and flaws of all humanity, and therefore are instructive for us these days. This includes the prophetic words of Jacob over all of his sons. So, I'd love to get into this. By the way, when I taught this, I actually came across all this when studying the book of Revelation and wondering about the 144,000.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
By the way, they are not Jehovah's Witnesses,
yes.
And it's not a literal number. Just thought I'd get that out there before. In case some of you were deceived. In case some of you were wondering. All right. Foundational understanding the spiritual realities that the 12 tribes speak of is the meaning of their names with the spiritual application. Each name speaks of a development in the growth of the Christian to come into the state of being seated on the right hand of God. Okay? Now, listen, I can't go into all that I taught that during that Revelation series. I think it took me 4 or 5 weeks to get through that. But I want to give you the seed of it and get you hungry to study for yourself. Okay? Because he said, study to show yourself. Oh, Will I be approved if I don't study? Now, I'm not talking about studying the way I do. I'm talking about God leading you in your study. Some of you may study devotionally. Some of you may study theologically. Some of you may study academically. But there is a study that the Holy Spirit and a way of studying that the Holy Spirit will lead you in. Okay? Let Him do it. Don't think, oh, well, I'm not studying like Dr. Bill, so I don't study. No, no. Sister Alani's here this morning, and you cannot get out of any of her classes without hearing some stories. And those stories are the study of God in Sister Alani's life. By the way, she's teaching Tuesday night at 6:30. Right? All right. I have to get those in while I think of them or I'll forget. All right. The flow of each in and out of the 13 listings speak of a spiritual journey and input to the final listing in Revelation. God always builds towards a climax, and the listing in Revelation is the climax of God's dealing with both natural Israel and the Israel of God. Now, let me just mention this. I don't think I have enough for everyone, but I have the 13 listings in one chart. And I wasn't sure whether I was going to get to it this morning or not. I definitely not going to get to the details of it, but it's there. The following charts outline that journey with the spiritual equivalent to the meaning of the names. And what we're going to do is we're going to talk about the regular name, what they were named at birth, and what it means spiritually. And then as we go through the patriarchal blessings on these charts, we're going to see what it means prophetically in that context. That happens all the way through with every one of these listings. Okay, the chart on the tribal names. Reuben was the firstborn. It means see his son. And that speaks to the vision of the level of relationship that's available to you. Simeon means hearing. Hearing the voice of God. By the way, hearing God is, if the order is right, I believe it is, hearing God is the most important thing. Remember this. Hebrews says, when for the time you ought to be teachers, you need that one teach you again what be the first principles of the what? What's the word or of one name? The voice of God, the speaking of God. The milk of the word is the speaking of God, not doctrine. Amen. Give that a moment to sink in. What happens when the mother feeds breastfeeds the baby? There is bonding. And we do not teach God's people how to bond with God. So the hearing of the voice of God is very, very important. Levi means join, union with God. This is spiritual meaning. Judah means praise, learning to worship, not just to sing songs, but learning to worship in the Spirit. I was brought up in a very legalistic church, and we were taught that we were the only ones who knew how to worship. And yet I saw more of God in a fellow who would be in a church equivalent to the United Methodist Church down here than I did in my Pentecostal brethren. And I said, Lord, what is it? He said, He worships me. And so I eventually came to the place where I could walk into the Anglican church that was next to my high school, feel the presence of God, listen to them worship, and find that place in the spirit of those who were worshiping and align myself with them. Because you see, worship is a spiritual reality, not a natural reality. And we can have all the singing we want and still have no worship.
Amen.
But we can worship and heaven comes down. We want to be a people of the presence of God. Okay? and worship. If you worship, he will come. Dan means judge me. Learning to judge myself so I will not be judged. Naphtali means my wrestling. Great wrestling with God and our Jacob nature. Of course, I know most of you are probably delivered from yours, but I still have some. Okay? Gad, a troop or a company. Catching a vision of overcoming. We need to catch a vision that it is possible to overcome every situation with the right attitude. You haven't overcome till you come to the right attitude. Okay? Asher, happiness, the joy of the Lord. Issachar, to hire. And here's something that came to me when I was looking at this. Called to the vineyard. Not... Oh, I'd get myself in trouble. Some of us, listen, the vineyard is the church. When you're looking for lost sheep, never forget they're sheep already. The only thing that is a type of sinners is fish. So if you want to be fishy, that's okay. Are you hearing me? What we try and do is we try and mix all the metaphors. And then we don't understand why certain things don't work for us. God calls a ministry to the vineyard. To care for the vineyard. That's his people. He said, I am the vine. And if I'm to work in the vineyard, I need to know the vine. Time to be attached, yes. Should we make an advertisement here for the biblical gardens?
Yeah.
Remind me, Debbie, I want to give you some time at the end, please. Okay. Zebulun, to dwell. Coming to dwell in him and he in us. That can be a three-stage operation. An outer court operation, a holy place operation, and the holiest of all operation. Or, Jesus said, I will come in you. I will send the Holy Spirit, the holy place operation. And then he said, the Father and I will come and dwell in you. That's the holiest of all operation. Did you catch that? You can ask me questions later. All right. Joseph means adding or fruitfulness. And Benjamin means the son of my old age. Or the son of my right hand. It's interesting that Benjamin's the only one that had two names. His mother named him son of my sorrow. And here's what God spoke to me when I asked him why. He said the suffering to enter into the right hand of God. Because if we suffer with him, we shall reign with him. Now that's just a rough view or outline. So the patriarchal blessings, just as the children had been prophetically named, so the prophetic blessing defined their purpose, place in the nation and in the economy of the plan of God. Their name prophetically defines that. Spiritual tribes are important. As we mature, each one will come to know what the emphasis of God is for their lives and where they fit in the holy nation. Israel is a type and shadow. Natural Israel is a type and shadow. And yet we've never drawn it into the Israel of God. So we have people wondering where they belong. You can know where you belong. You can know what God has called you to. You can know the emphasis of God for you. You can find your lane and stay in it and cause the body of Christ to grow because you're willing to not try and do everything. The emphasis of God in his dealing in our lives often denotes what tribe we are of. Remember this, we're one nation of those 12 tribes. Don't get so caught up with the tribal emphasis that you forget your national responsibilities. Let me say that again. Don't get so caught up with the tribal emphasis that you forget your national responsibilities. Many churches are caught up with their tribal responsibilities and do not realize we are one holy nation. So let's look at the patriarchal blessings. Reuben, see his son. The prophetic word was, he was the beginning of strength. He was excellent in dignity and excellent in power. But notice the negatives. And why do I talk about the negatives? Because you can have the power, the strength, the power, the excellent dignity, but you can be unstable as water. And if that's the case, you will not accept. See, one of the things, part of our problem as Christians is we focus on the negative, some focus on the negative, but we focus on the positive and don't realize that the positive can be there, but there can still be things that need to be moved out.
Yes, yes, yes.
Okay? Simeon means hearing. And basically, he said, Simeon, instruments of cruelty were in your habitation. What precipitated that? Because without asking Dad, they went and killed a whole bunch of people. And there should have been some type of justice administered. There's no question there. But they took it upon themselves to not submit to the authority that was over them. And because they did, instruments of cruelty in your habitation, you're not going to have your own inheritance. I'm going to scatter you throughout all Israel. But there's a positive of that that the Lord spoke to me as I was restudying this. He said, Bill, that means every nation or every tribe has to have a dimension of hearing. There has to be an ability to hear in every tribe. And that's what prophetically scattering Simeon in Israel did. Levi. And of course his name means joint. And instruments are cruel here in their habitation. He said, I'm going to divide them in Jacob, I'll scatter them in Israel. If you come in the morning, I'm going to talk about some of the reason for that, because we're going into cities of refuge. Okay? I'll scatter them in Israel. Note this. They were chosen as priests to slay the animals for sacrifice. Was an instrument of cruelty in their hands? But God turned that which was negative to good, didn't he? Because the way of people coming to God was through sacrifice. Because without the shedding of blood, there was no remission of sin. So God took what had been a curse and changed it. They were still scattered in Israel. They still had those consequences. But they also became the holders, as it were, or the government of the cities of refuge. Okay? Note that even in being cursed, they were elevated to minister unto the people and unto the Lord. Who can understand the wisdom of our God? Judah, celebrate with praise. You know, we need to learn how to celebrate, not just praise. Come on now.
Yes.
We need to learn to celebrate, not just praise.
Hallelujah.
He shall be praised by his brethren. His hand shall be upon the neck of his enemies. Judah lasted longer than Israel, didn't they? Israel, the northern tribes went into bondage. Judah lasted longer. I call this worship warfare. Because worship, it said, you send Judah first. What does worship do? It confuses the enemy. Hallelujah. Why does it confuse the enemy? Because he wants the worship. Okay? His father's children shall bow down before him. That happened during David's reign, didn't it? The scepter shall not depart from Judah. The Davidic tabernacle, the throne in the millennium, because David is being raised to rule over Jerusalem for the 1,000-year reign. Still have the scepter. Still have the authority. By the way, all of these have spiritual realities that God is bringing forth in the church today. Those who will let God deal with them and let God work in their life, we are going to see the spiritual realities of these blessings of activated in the church, or activated in a, let's put it this way, in a people. Okay? A lawgiver shall not depart from his feet, or the scepter of the kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of God. God is in the kingdom. Okay? Because in the end, the kingdoms of the kingdoms, plural, of this world become the kingdoms of our God and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. I wish I had time to go into some of this, but I don't. I'm just trying to sow some seed here. Okay? Until Shiloh come, that means he whose right it is to rule. Remember that God is making of a people kings and priests, and we shall reign on the earth. Those who allow God to make them will have the right to rule. It's not automatic. It's giving myself to him and let him change me. Because he loves me as I am, but he loves me so much he's going to change me to be like he is. That's the love of God. Okay? Unto Shiloh, he whose right it is to rule, shall the gathering of his people be. Now, prophetically, that's first and foremost Jesus Christ. Okay? Yet, it has an application to the corporate man in the end time. I beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord and by our gathering together unto him, that you be not soon shaken. Where? Where's the battle? In the mind. And he goes on then. Binding his foal under the vine, bearing, burden bearing, tied to the relationship of the vine and the branches. Remember, what God wants to do is take us to the land of spiritual milk and honey. It took two to carry one bunch of grapes. I kind of think that was Joshua and Caleb. And God's looking for some Joshua and Calebs in this hour who will be willing to press in and have another spirit. And listen, because they did that, they become the leaders of the next generation. It isn't just a blessing they get to last a little longer, live a little longer. It's that they become the leadership because they were faithful to the purpose and will of God. His ass to the choice vine, and I'm reminded of the triumphal entry. You know that God is going to have a triumphal entry in these last days. Come on now. His triumph is going to be manifest in the last days. We are to follow in his steps. Most of us want a helicopter ride past the cross. Come on. You know, we start at the Last Supper and then we helicopter ride to the resurrection. Sorry, his steps didn't have a helicopter anywhere. I need the Garden of Gethsemane to bring my will into subjection to his will. Father, if there's any other way, what was he wrestling with? I'd like to get out of this. Come on. Nevertheless, not my will. My will is to get out of here. Some people, oh, no, I won't go there. I will behave myself. Oh, it's hard. All right. God is bringing a people to manifest his triumph before he comes. Note that at the triumphal entry, there was worship. His garments washed in wine, his clothes in the blood of grapes, and his eyes red with wine, all speaking of the power and the application of the blood, and his teeth white with milk. Let's move on. I wish I had time to go into each of those, but we don't. Zebulun to dwell. He shall dwell as a haven of the sea, or be a harbor, safety in the storm. You realize there's a storm coming? And I'm not speaking of the Jacksonville rains. There's a storm coming. And there's going to be havens. The tribe of Zebulun, those called to walk in that, are going to be used as havens in the storm. People are going to come. Also, another parallel for that is the cities of refuge. There are going to be places and cities, whole cities in the nation that become places where God is going to protect. Yes. He shall be a haven of ships. His borders shall be under Zidon. And Zidon means to hunt or to wait, to lie in wait. You know, something that comes to me is they that seek me early shall find me. How many know that when you're seeking for something, it's not obvious? I know I have an acute grasp of the obvious. Anyway, but you hear me. We have been living in the ask realm too long. Ask and you shall receive. And the ask realm becomes the enemy of the seek realm, because when I ask and I get it, then I think I should always get what I ask for. But there are some things in God that he wants us to seek. And he said, seek wisdom. Seek ye the Lord. What's the rest of that verse? Oh, you mean there's going to be a time when he's not going to allow himself to be found? There are cutoff points. It was 120 years that God extended mercy while Noah was building the ark. But there did come a cutoff point. And too often, we think the mercy of God is saying, it's not going to happen. No, it'll happen. After all, he said it would happen. He never lies. But God is wanting to get a people ready for that time so that there will be safe places in the earth. Issachar to hire is... Issachar is a strong ass couching down between two burdens. And as I was thinking of this, Galatians 6, verses 2 and 5 came. One says, bear ye one another's burden. And then it says, let every man bear his own burden. Lord, give me the wisdom to know the difference. Again, my favorite illustration. There's a balance in Scripture that God wants us to catch, so that we walk and manifest both aspects of his character and nature. In any given thing he's called us to do. Issachar has a vision of rest that is good. In Hebrews 4, 1 through 6, there is a rest. There is a rest for the children of God. He has a vision of a land, or his vision is that the land is pleasant. And I think that vision is an attitude. Come on. That vision is an attitude. I wish I had time to go into this. But I just want to get you thinking. Are you thinking yet?
Yes.
Good, good. then I've accomplished my purpose. You want me to quit?
No.
Okay. Because of this, he bows his shoulder to the burden. In other words, because he has vision for the land and that the land is pleasant, and he had a vision of rest, he's willing to work because he's headed to the rest.
Yes.
And he carries a servant attitude. He knows the times and the seasons and what Israel ought to do. So he carries a servant attitude. God, bring your ministry to a servant attitude. Bring your people to a servant attitude. If we will get a servant attitude, we will win far more to the Lord than the attitude that has been portrayed in the past. Dan, judge me. He shall judge his people. Dan represents judgment. The danger of judging is a legalistic spirit. That's the snare of knowing the law. Just, all right. Dan is also a serpent by way or a snake in the grass. He was the first to go into idolatry. And he is not in the listing in Revelation. He did not make it all the way through the dealings of God. He is an adder in the path. He bites the heel of the flesh, causing the rider to become imbalanced. Genesis 3:15, what does that say? The serpent shall nip at, that's what the word means, nip at your heel. You shall bruise his head, but he's going to nip at your heel. When something's nipping at your heel, how balanced are you? I don't mind the big dogs, it's the chihuahuas.
Jack Russell.
It's the little foxes that spoil the vine. The one with the sharp teeth, pin-sized teeth. Keep you in balance. Gad, a troop or a company, it will look, now catch this, because this has direct application to Revelation 2 and 3. It will look like Gad is being overcome. In other words, it'll look like the overcomer is not going to overcome. But he will overcome in the end. He'll snatch victory out of defeat.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Revelation 2 and 3 and Revelation 11, 11. These are the children of the resurrection from Luke 20 and verse 36. You know, God always has an ace in the hole when he's playing cards. It's called resurrection. It always defeats the joker. All right. Asher means happiness. Asher's promise, good bread. Can this be related to Jesus as the bread of life, as well as the corporate expression, we being many are one bread? Throughout, he yields the dainties belonging to kings, or he has royal food. God wants to give a people royal food, his food. You know what the danger of royal food is? Despising it. Despising it. Isn't that what Israel did with the manna that was angels' food?
That's right.
I'll just leave that one there. Naphtali means my wrestling. Now you'll notice that I have separated that out there. In the middle of wrestling, there is rest. God gives freedom to this one, even though his nature is to wrestle. He gives good words or edifying words in 1 Corinthians 14:26. And one who is willing to walk in Ephesians 6, wrestling against principalities and powers. 1 Corinthians 10:5. also, which is bringing into thought or bringing into captivity every. By the way, you can't take a dead thing captive, can you? Does that mean my thoughts are living things? You mean they have a mind of their own? Any of you who are going to be honest will say yes. Lord, bring us into the rest during our wrestling. Help us to learn to wrestle from a position of resting in you and in what you've said about a situation or a problem. Joseph, he is a fruitful bough by a well. The well represents a reservoir of the word. His branches run over the wall. Remember that any crop that went over the wall was for the stranger, the poor, and the traveler. France is blessed because they've taken that Levitical law and made it law in France. You're going down the road and there's a vine over the wall, you can pick that and take it without any repercussions. God has blessed France because of the measure of the word they're willing. You say, but they're this, economically they're blessed. And part of it is, the reason is, they're walking in this law of the Lord. The archers have sorely grieved him. They shot him. They hated him. These are all experiences that we go through that God wants to bring us through. Too many get stuck in and give up before God has brought them all the way through. And Joseph is an example of God making a man, God sending a man. It says that Joseph was sent of God to Egypt. Well, I would have looked at the first 13 years after he left Canaan as not being sent by God. But in order to be properly sent, I have to be properly prepared. And God was preparing his man, testing the attitudes, adjusting attitudes, so that when he came to the throne of Egypt, there was nothing in him that wanted something for himself. He was willing to serve the people, serve the ungodly, because that's how he started. There weren't too many saved people in Egypt when Joseph came to the throne. But Joseph's attitude and Joseph's heart for the people won the love of all of the Egyptians. Oh Lord, bring some Josephs along the way today. Yes. His bow abode in strength because of the spirit of might on him? I believe so. His hands were made strong by the hand of the Almighty. And the Almighty will, not just God. When God talks about the Almighty, it means all the strength of God. So when he says the Almighty, the hand of the Almighty is upon him, and he says the Almighty will help thee, the whole fullness of the Godhead comes to your aid. Wow. How many know we have no comprehension of the fullness of the Godhead? But God is going to manifest all this in these days. Now Joseph is especially blessed. He's blessed of heaven above. He's blessed. You mean he walks in blessing? How many know that we've not really seen the blessing of God in the end here, in the end time? God is going to manifest. You see, when it's all said and done, no one will have an excuse not to know God. That means there's got to be a manifestation that convinces everyone that God is who he says he is, and they have a choice to accept it or reject it. In other words, the purity of who God is about to be manifest in a people. He's blessed of heaven above, blessed of the deep that lieth under, blessed of the breast, blessed of the womb. The blessings of Jacob were stronger for him than the blessings of Abraham and Isaac. Now this speaks of an exponential generational increase. Colossians 2:19 would put it in the dimension of the increase of God. Now there's a phrase we haven't got a clue about, but we're going to see it in these end times. The blessing of Jacob will be a covering for Joseph, and the blessings will be a crown. The blessings will be what? A crown representing a level of royal authority. God is going to bring forth his true authority in the end time, in and through a people.
Amen.
I'm a candidate. How about you?
Yes.
So Benjamin, son of my old age, his intensity, or you mean he's going to be intense? How many love intense people? I'm not one. I'm not intense at all. You understand? All right, you can cast the lying spirit on the athletes. All right. His intensity will be that of a ravening wolf. And in the morning he will devour the prey. And at night after war, he'll divide the spoils. This speaks of winning the war.
Yes.
The spoils don't go to the guy who is defeated. And God is about to teach his people what taking spoils of war is like. Just let me say this, I've said it before, but I'm going to say it until I get it in my own spirit, and you guys can come along with me. And that is this, that when you spoil the enemy, you take away his weapons and melt them down. So it takes him a period of time to remake weapons, and you get rest. How many have fought the enemy, won the war, and the next day he's back with the same weapon? Come on.
Yep.
I'm saying, God, there's some revelation on spiritual warfare yet to come down the pipe.
Yes.
Okay? The dual name speaks of two areas of dealing. A favored son, Joseph. Remember, Joseph gave him five times what he gave the other brothers. There is a company of people who are going to rise to the son of the right hand who are going to have five times as much as everyone else. And again, it's God's choice, not mine. And if I take the thing, well, see me, guess what? I lose it. Pride causes loss. My cry is, God, make me such a steward that I will still give it all away. Both naturally and spiritually. Listen, some of you, God has given abundant revelation to. Okay? And the only reason he gives it to you is he wants you to learn to give it away. A son who goes through sorrows to come to maturity. Some are not willing to go through the sorrows that it takes to come to full maturity, or that it takes to come to the throne. But the sorrows will purge out of you that which would cause you to steward the throne authority wrong. Okay? If we suffer with him, what does it say? We will reign with him. We like that we will reign with him, but we don't like the if we suffer. Remember what I say about grapes? If the grape is squeezed, you find out what's inside. If it's ripe, it's wine. If it's not ripe, it's wine. There are a lot of unripe grapes in the kingdom. All right. How do I know?
Why did you do this to me, God? I did not deserve this. I've been faithful to you all these years, and now this is what I get.
This chart speaks of a restoration of the lost tribes of Israel. Because if we're talking about balance, The Israel of God is not only going to come, but God's going to restore natural Israel, all of it. Please hear that.
Wow.
He's got to restore all of it in order to graft Israel back in. It also has powerful prophetic implications for the end time body of Christ. So here's the emphasis. There's a value in the blessing of the fathers. In all these Old Testament events, there are spiritual principles that can be extracted and applied. Thirdly, there is an Israel of God from Galatians 6:16. In the spiritual realm as well, there as there being a natural Israel. It's not one or the other. The principles apply to both. Thank God. Now, this shows us how to pray for natural Israel. We pray for restoration. We pray for restoration of the tribes. We don't try and tell God how to do it. That's a Christian problem right there. Isn't it?
Amen.
And when he doesn't do it our way, we show our immaturity. I mean, we want it. Yeah. The Holy Spirit will teach us how to apply them, but there is prophetic application of all that happened and happens to natural Israel. Four, we need to consider asking God what his emphasis for us is individually and corporately. One of the things God is speaking to Dr. Ed and I and the leadership here about is the DNA of CMC. What is the DNA of CMC? What's God's vision? Not the general vision of the church, the specific application of God prophetically to this house. We're not going to be like any other place in the city. We're not called to be. We've got to stop trying to clone Christ. Thank you. Does it fall within the spiritual principles of Jacob's prophetic blessing and pronouncement over his people? There, number five, there is a spiritual heritage that God wants us to leave our children, a legacy that goes into eternity if they will receive it. The legacy of these prophecies went all the way to Revelation and the 144,000. That's a long time. And obviously that also goes into eternity. This is also true of our spiritual children. What legacy are we leaving our children, natural or spiritual? Listen, as natural parents, we have natural children. What we don't realize is that they pick up something from us in their spirit, and we can pray into that if they're erring kids. Oh, I wish we could hear that. There is great hope. The very fact that you're sitting here this morning, there's great hope for your children. Come on. Come on. How many know that God sows incorruptible seed? It's not only incorruptible, it's certified.
Amen.
That means it's impossible for it not to grow. All right. Now just let me say this before we pray. I want you to hold steady. We've got a couple of very important announcements after prayer. But I think we need to talk to God both as a corporate body, but as individuals. Because God wants to bring us into many of the things spiritually that I've been teaching on this morning. And I just sowed the seed. Believe me, I did not go into the depth of it. But I sowed the seed because the seed he sows is incorruptible and is certified. All right? Heavenly Father, thank you for these examples of true blessing and of the prophetic. would you bring your people into the realm of all of these prophetic abilities. Help us to realize the length, depth, height, and breadth of what you desire to bring us into. Bring us to a value of the spiritual principles displayed in this awesome prophetic chapter. Release your people to walk into the full maturity of the prophetic on all levels. If our covenant is greater than theirs, then there's a greater realm to the prophetic than the Old Testament saints and prophets functioned in. Help us to allow the Holy Spirit to lead us into these truths. Would you also show us our tribe that we might find our true place and emphasis in your holy nation, we pray. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, Amen. Sister Sandra.